Well, I'd like to take your Bibles, if you would, and turn with me to 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 3 through 10 will be our text this morning. The title of our sermon is, With Eternity's Values in View. Now, some of you are saying, there's a song that goes something like that. Well, there is, but we're not going to sing that song this morning. But as we work our way through this text, we will see that what Paul is trying to get across to Timothy here is that you and I, as believers, need to be living with not the temporal, not the temporary things in mind, but with eternity in mind, that which is going to last for all of eternity. So as we pick up our study of 1 Timothy, we see that Paul calls us to holy living. Now, this call to holy living ties in very nicely with our memory verse 2 weeks ago. Okay, the memory verse was 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15, which says, But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. That leads us to holy living. We talked about holy living, and what it means to be holy means to be set apart. You and I, as God's children, have been called to be set apart from that which is sinful and worldly, and set apart unto that which is God-honoring, and that which leads to Christ-likeness. So Paul's call to holiness here is where we are moving this morning in our text, and he's instructing Timothy as he calls young men to ministry, full-time pastoral ministry. They must be individuals who have been set apart to holy, God-honoring, Christ-like living. Follow along in your text as I read from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 3 through 10. It says this, If anyone teaches you and does not consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which accords with godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing, but is obsessed with disputes and arguments over words, from which come envy, strife, reviling, evil suspicions, useless wranglings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a means of gain. From such, withdraw yourself. Now, godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing, with these we shall be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, as we look at your text this morning, passages from your word, we ask that you would challenge us today. You would help us to make sure that we are living our lives not for the here and now, but with eternity's values in view. Father, we want to honor you. We want to glorify you. We want you to be pleased with the life that we live. And the only way that can be true is if we're living based upon the principles that we find in your word. Bless our study this morning as we look into your word, and we ask that you would challenge us, you would send us away from this place this morning, having been confronted with the word of God, and either be able to evaluate and say, hey, I'm on the right path, I'm doing what I need to be doing, or maybe saying, hey, I need to make a direction change here, I need to make a correction here, I need to do this rather than this. Father, as we leave, may we be able to say that we're more like our Savior, Jesus Christ, because we spent time in your word this morning. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Well, Paul moves from reminding Timothy that he needs to teach those in the church the importance of serving their masters. That's where we were 2 weeks ago in our study in 1 Timothy about honoring God in the workplace and living before our employers as we ought to. He moves into serving the Lord and talking about godliness and what godliness looks like in the child of God. He tells us that godlessness looks like this and godliness looks like this. So, if you haven't opened your passage of scripture, if you haven't opened your text this morning to 1 Timothy chapter 6, please do that. We're going to take a look this morning at verses 3 through 5, and we see here, godlessness has the marks of the conceited. Godlessness. Okay? That means we've left God out of the picture. We've made a deliberate choice to say, I don't need God in this part of my life. Now, unfortunately, our world is becoming more and more like that, where they are saying over and over and over in all aspects of life, we don't want God interfering with our lives in the public school. We don't want God interfering with our lives in the government. We don't want God here. You see, godlessness has the marks of the conceited. Why do we say that? Because what you are saying when you remove God from the picture, you're saying, I'm okay, God. I'm pretty good. I'm good enough. I'm better than you. I don't need you. That makes you a conceited individual, placing yourself on a level par or a level playing surface with our great God. What does godlessness look like? If we want to make sure that we're not getting caught up in godlessness, we need to know what it looks like. Well, the godless are marked by the misuse of words. The misuse of words. In other words, they might take some of the very same words that we have and use them differently. How many words can you think about? You don't have to answer this out loud. But how many words have we had to change simply because the world has hijacked them? One that we can take most recently is, we used to call ourselves fundamentalists. I don't know about you, but I don't go around telling people I'm a fundamentalist anymore because they might think I have a bomb strapped to my belt. Because that's what a fundamentalist does. I mean, that's why we can't go through the airport in 10 minutes anymore. It takes you 45 minutes to get through the line to get into where you want to go so you can fly someplace. We are still fundamentalists. We still hold to the truth of God's word as the fundamental source of what we believe and what we practice. But we've had to change that word. We used to say, we're Baptists. But have you looked around at some of our Baptist literature? It now says we're independent Baptists. We've had to add it because the word Baptist was changed in this definition. So now we're independent Baptists, and then we became independent fundamental Baptists, but we dropped fundamental because that's not such a good word anymore. But we were independent fundamental Bible-believing Baptists. See, there was a time in the history of our world where if you were a Baptist, you were a Bible-believing person. But now there's Baptists that aren't Bible-believing, so we have to say we're independent, fundamental, Bible-believing Baptists. Okay? You see, definitions change, and that's because the godless misuse the words that we hold so near and dear to our hearts. Some people that we know and love and respect and honor used to drive around with little fishes on their car. We can't do that anymore because the New Age stole the fish. So if you have a fish on your car now, you might have to put underneath it, I'm not a New Ager. You see, we have to define our terms and we have to redefine our terms because they get misused by the godless. You see, the godless, they practice contrary teaching. Okay, contrary to what Timothy, or Paul says to Timothy here in chapter 6, verse 3, if anyone teaches otherwise and does not consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which accords with godliness. They teach contrary. Paul is talking specifically about what he just instructed Timothy in regard to in verses 1 and 2, and that's about how you conduct yourself in a servant-master relationship, or today we would say an employer-employee relationship. Okay? There were people teaching contrary to what God had instructed. We can broaden that and we can say it's in regard to all of the apostolic teaching. There were people cropping up in Ephesus, in Corinth, and all kinds of places just like there are today who are teaching contrary to the Word of God, contrary to apostolic teaching, contrary to the words that Jesus said when he said, go into all the world and make disciples and teach them whatsoever I have commanded you. That's what they're changing. They're teaching contrary to that. Oh, we don't need to teach that anymore. In fact, we're beyond that. We're past that. We now live in the year 2014, and we don't need that anymore. If somebody tells you that, tell them that they're lying to you. It's rubbish. It's nonsense. This book is an eternal book. It never changes. And we need it today, maybe more than we needed it 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. We need to make sure that this book drives our course, sets us on the path that we need to go. Paul said over in Galatians chapter 1, verse 8, "But even if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed." You see, that's how serious Paul takes sound teaching. So I say to you, if somebody comes and stands behind this pulpit, be it me or somebody else, and they start teaching you something that is not in God's word, throw them out. Don't let them stand here and desecrate the word of God or the history and the tradition of this church. Because this church has a tradition and a history of being a God-honoring, Bible-believing, Bible-teaching, stand-for-what-is-right kind of a church. And if somebody tries to change that, we don't want them here. As harsh as that may sound, it's not mean-spirited, it's not being nasty, it's simply defending the faith and standing for what is true and what is right. Now, what makes it worse that they're teaching contrary teaching? You know, sometimes people teach things and they don't know that they're teaching something wrong. But these people, they won't consent to edification. You try to say to them, "Hey, you know what? That's really not what the Bible says. That's really not what it means." And they say, "Oh, don't you try to tell me what the Bible says. I know what the Bible says." Well, then you're not teaching it. You see, they won't consent to edification. They won't agree. You see, the aim of false teachers is not to edify the body of Christ, but it's to destroy the body of Christ. The godless refuse edification. They're more willing to tear down the body of Christ and to cause disunity than they are to receive edification. Over in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29, Paul says this, "Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers." You see, corrupt words or unwholesome communication cannot result in building up the body. So it should not be part of the behavior of the child of God, of one who makes up the body of Christ. Wholesome words or words that edify are akin to the words of our Savior. When we speak those kinds of words, we're speaking the words of Christ. We also see that those who are godless, they promote conflicting doctrine. Paul also says that they will not conform to what is true and what is right. So their very behavior, their very speech, they promote a doctrine that is divisive and a doctrine that is different from what our Lord Jesus Christ taught. Do we hear that today? All you got to do is turn the TV on. And most of what you hear coming across the airwaves is a bit suspect. That's why this book must always be our sole authority for faith and practice. I love it when people call me up and say, "Pastor, I heard this. Is it true?" Well, I hope, first of all, you've checked it out yourself to see if it's true, and you've said, "You know, I can't quite figure this out." But there's never anything wrong with trying to make sure that what you believe is true. I mean, Paul himself said, "Be more like the Bereans who search the scriptures daily to find out whether these things are so." What was he talking about? He was talking about the very things that he had taught them. So he was glad that the Bereans were checking him out and making sure that his teaching lined up with the Word of God. As I was working my way through this message this week, I couldn't help but think of one of my new favorite songs. That's the nice thing about songs. You know, sometimes you get a new favorite one. Well, I liked this song so much, I went out and bought the album. I guess, I don't know if you call them that anymore or not, but I bought the whole set of songs on the particular disc, if we can call it that way. It's a song that's called Words by a group called Hawk Nelson. Let me read the words for you. I think you'll see why it's one of my favorite. It says, "Words, they've made me feel like a prisoner. They've made me feel set free. They've made me feel, they've lifted my heart to places I'd never been. And they've dragged me down back to where I began. Words can build you up. Words can break you down. Start a fire in your heart or put it out. Let my words be life. Let my words be truth. I don't want to say a word unless it points the world back to you. You can heal the heartache, speak over the fear. God, your voice is the only thing we need to hear. Words can build us up. Words can break us down. They can start a fire in your heart or put it out. Let my words be life. Let my words be truth. I don't want to say a word unless it points the world back to you. Let the words I say be the sound of your grace. I don't want to speak a word unless it points the world back to you. I want to speak your love, not just another noise. You see, a lot of the people that are talking in religious circles today, they're just talking noise. Our prayer is, I don't want my words to be just another noise. I want to be your light. I want to be your voice. Let my words be life. Let my words be true. I don't want to say a word unless it points the world back to you. I want my words to be seasoned with your grace. Words that build us up, not words that tear us down. I want words that will start a fire in our hearts for the Lord Jesus Christ, not words that'll put it out. Great words for us to think about and to put into practice in our daily life. We want to make sure that we are not misusing words, but we are using them for God's purpose. We also see in our text that the godless have character that is malicious. What's malicious character? Well, Paul says they're proud. They're conceited. The Greek word actually means to envelop with smoke. Okay? Maybe you've heard the old way of kind of getting people to come in and buy something, smoke and mirrors, okay? Enveloped in smoke. Why? What's the problem of something being enveloped in smoke? You can't see the truth of it. You can't see the reality of it. Your vision is clouded. You can't see if it's really going to accomplish what they say it's going to accomplish or not. The words of the godless are full of smoke, and you can't really tell what's going on. Paul says they know nothing. They're void of comprehension. They don't understand the truth of God's word. They have no understanding when it comes to spiritual or biblical matters. And then he says they're obsessed with disputes. They're compelled to be divisive. They get themselves embroiled in arguments over words, which results in envy, strife, reviling, evil suspicions. That's the godless. Now, we would look at that and say, huh, we don't want anything to do with that. And yet, they don't come across that way. They disguise themselves. They hide themselves. Some of them have really big smiles. And they say, we want you to do this, and you know what? God wants you to be happy and healthy and prosperous. And you should never be without anything that you want in life, because God wants you to have it all. That's how they hide themselves. Don't fall into the trap of the godless. Rather, we want to be marked by godliness. And godliness brings gain through contentment in verses 6 through 8. Let me just read that again for you. It says there, now godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing with these, we shall be content. You see, man's pursuit for the material, it's fleeting. It's only going to be here for a short time. It's going to be here maybe for as long as you live. But you know what? When you mark as long as you live in accordance with how long history is, it's relatively short. And if you want to say, yeah, but you know, we'll be here, our memories, the legacy we leave behind will be here longer than we are. Well, okay. But even if you take into account the whole entirety of the world, it pales. It's short in comparison to eternity. Paul says, if we have godliness in our life, if we are living godly, it's an eternal asset. It won't fade away. But realize this, Timothy, and those that you are placing in positions of leadership, the pursuit for the material is fleeting. How do you know that, Paul? Well, he says, we entered the world with no material goods. We didn't bring anything in when we entered the world. Now, I got to tell you, I was present for the actual birth of two of our children. The plan was to be present for all three of them, but Joshua didn't cooperate, and he had to be delivered by an emergency C-section. So he was in the room with mommy, and I didn't get to see him come into the world. But I was there for Rachel, and I was there for Micah. And you know what? They didn't have anything. They came out, pardon the expression, but buck naked. Nothing! But you know what? It didn't take long for them to latch on to certain things that became their favorites. This was Joshua's favorite. He wasn't very old, but one of the men down in that was working at Camp Manitoumi, good friend of the family, Barb's mom and dad's family, Roland went out and bought this teddy bear for Josh. Yeah, because Josh was really kind of enthralled by Roland for whatever reason. And Roland was so taken in by that, he went out that day and he bought this teddy bear. And Joshua just kind of clung to this teddy bear. Everywhere we went, Joshua had to have his teddy bear. If he didn't have his teddy bear, he got very upset. And if anybody tried to take his teddy bear away from him, oh man, forget that. No way. That wasn't going to happen. He was very, very possessive of this teddy bear. Now, for Rachel, it was this. Little old rag doll. Doesn't look like much. But just like her brother, don't you take my doll away from me. She didn't carry it by the arm. You know how she carried it? By the hair. It's a loved little doll. Been repaired a couple times. Now, the braids have come out. Micah, on the other hand, he wasn't into dolls or bears. It was balls for him. Okay? Somebody sent us a package when Micah was born. It had this little vinyl ball, and it's soft on the inside. Looked like a baseball. Actually looked more like a softball because that's about the size of it. He had that thing. He sucked on it. He chewed on it. He took it wherever. It was always in the diaper bag. It went where we went. One day, the older boys, we had a missionary. We had a co-worker whose nephew came to visit. And they were playing with Micah's ball, which he wasn't too happy about, but as long as he could see it, it was okay. The ball eventually got outside and ended up being thrown up on the roof of the town hall. We couldn't get there. And when we went home without the ball, Micah was not a happy camper. The visitor felt so bad that when he got back to the States, he bought another one and sent a new one back to Micah. Okay? You see, we gravitate to these things that are ours, and nobody can take them. Nobody can have them. It's a material good, and I want it, and nobody better even think about taking it away from me. We didn't come into the world with it. We think we're going to go out of the world with it at that moment in time, but guess what? Paul says, uh-uh. You entered the world with nothing. And guess what? You're going to exit the world with nothing. Many people at this point in a sermon would say, have you ever seen a hearse carrying a U-Haul? Have you? I can't say that anymore because I did in South Africa. We actually saw a U-Haul carrying, with a hearse with a U-Haul behind it, a trailer behind it. It wasn't used as a hearse anymore, but it still was a hearse. Once a hearse, always a hearse, okay? But you know what? When we leave this world, we're not taking anything with us. It's going to stay right here. And it's probably going to rot. Makes me think of a quote from a famous missionary who was a cricketer before he was a missionary. His name was C.T. Studd. He wrote these words, "Only one life twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last." Have you ever heard that before? Do you know that that comes from a poem that C.T. Studd penned after he quit being a cricket player and gave up all of his possessions? He figured he had about 29,000 pounds European money to his name because he was ended his cricket playing career. He wrote 4 checks for 5,000 pounds to 4 different agencies. One was George Mueller and his orphans. One was the Salvation Army. I can't remember the other two off the top of my head. And then he wrote 5 more checks for 1,000 pounds each. So what did he have left? Nothing. Gave it all away. He went to the mission field. And he penned these words. 2 little lines I heard one day, traveling along life's busy way, bringing conviction to my heart and from my mind would not depart. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, yes, only one. Soon will its fleeting hours be done. Then in that day my Lord to meet and stand before his judgment seat. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, the still small voice gently pleads for a better choice, bidding me selfish aims to leave and to God's holy will to cleave. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, a few brief years, each with its burdens, hopes, and fears, each with its days I must fulfill, living for self or in his will. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. With this bright world would tempt me sore, when Satan would victory score, when self would seek to have its way, then help me, Lord, with joy to say, only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Give me, Father, a purpose deep, in joy or sorrow, thy word to keep. Faithful and true, whate'er the strife, pleasing thee in my daily life. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Oh, let my love with fervor burn, and from the world now let me turn, living for thee and thee alone, bringing thee pleasure on thy throne. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, yes, only one. Now let me say, thy will be done. And when at last I hear the call, I know I'll say, 'twas worth it all. Only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last.'" Now, I understand that's quite a long poem. In fact, C.T. Studd didn't write short poems. But if you can only remember 2 lines, remember, only one life 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. That helps us put life into perspective. It's not about the pursuit for material gain. Rather, it's about God's provision for our needs, and those provisions should cause great contentment in our life. Paul says to Timothy, "Having food and clothing, with these we shall be content." That's all we need. Food and clothing. That's what makes us content. Say, I could do with a little more than that, Pastor. Well, we need to know this. God has promised to take care of us. Jesus taught this very thing to his early followers. Over in Matthew chapter 6, verses 31 through 34, we read this. "Therefore, do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear?' For after all these things, the Gentiles," or instead of saying Gentiles there, we could say the unbelievers seek. "For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things will what? be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own troubles. God has promised to take care of our needs. He's got promised to give us that which we need in life. We also see that God uses the body of Christ to provide for its own. One of the first messages I preached, it wasn't by choice, but it was a text that was handed out to me in homiletics class. It was from the book of Galatians chapter 6, verses 9 and 10. You may or may not know what those verses say, but they've kind of stuck with me down through the years because that was the first message I preached. It says there, and let us not grow weary in well-doing. Ever been there? Oh, man, I've been doing this. And you get weary in doing what is good. Paul says, don't grow weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, but catch this, especially to those who are of the household of faith. Where do we start with our doing good? Where do we start, if we can, with our charity? We start here in this body of believers. We start here in the household of faith, taking care of one another that God has placed us here. You know, it's common for us when we lived in South Africa to get beggars that would knock on our door. In fact, sometimes the police would drop them off and they would say, there's the pastor's house. So we'd get a knock on the door. Master, boss man, do you have this for me? Do you have something? I always would talk to them, first of all, about their spiritual condition. No, don't need that. No, you do need that. Then I would ask them, where do you go to church? Oh, I go to church out here in Kailicha. Or I go out here. Why are you doing it in Tableview? That's an hour away. No, I need this and I need that. I said, can't your church help you out? Well, my church doesn't help. I said, well, our church does. Our church takes care of the people in our church. We minister to the needs. Well, what church do you go to? I want to go to your church. You know, we as a church, and I think we do, we need to take care of our own. We have in our deacons meeting a section, a time, in every deacons meeting we call it good and welfare, where we talk about, are there needs that we are aware of in the body of Christ? And if there are, how do we meet those needs? How do we minister to the needs of the people in the body of Christ right here in Preble that God has entrusted to our care? We need to be doing that. So that puts a little responsibility on you. If you know of a need or if you are in need, you got to let us know, because if we don't know, we can't do anything about it. But the Bible says that we are supposed to take care of our own in the body of Christ. And then as it's left over, as God blesses, as God provides, we go out further. But let's start right in our own church. Which, by the way, you'll have an opportunity to do so on Tuesday. By going over the D hearts and saying, hey, you need something I can do. We've heard it already tonight or this morning that the Schiffers were blessed by somebody who came by and helped them out, put the dock back in, helped clean up around the place. We've heard others testify of God's goodness from the people within our church reaching out to help those in need. So we need to continue to do so. Never become content with, oh, I did that last week, or I did. No, let's keep doing it. Let's make sure that we're doing what we can to minister to the needs of our church family. We want to make sure that, you know, when you're serving others, it's strange how God brings a certain sense of satisfaction and contentment into your heart. You know, some of the hardest work that you'll do might be helping somebody out. And at the end of that, you say, wow, I'm tired, but it's a good kind of tired. And you know that because you've been used of the Lord. And it happens, and it will continue to happen, I'm sure, within our church family. We also see here that Paul says, exercise great care when it comes to money in verses 9 and 10. Now, these are the verses that kind of stick out and jump out off the text. It says, but those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish and harmful lusts and drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. What's Paul saying to Timothy as he appoints these elders that he needs to be watching out for? Well, he wants them to understand the heart of all evil. What's the heart of all evil? Now, this is a very misquoted passage of Scripture. Many think that this verse says, money is the root of all evil. Is that what that verse says? No, it's not. The verse says, the love of money is the root of all evil. How do we know if we have a problem with loving money? Because money in and of itself is not evil. God chooses to bless some people more than others, and he expects those people that he blesses with an abundance of money to use that in his service. But if you're loving money, you're not going to use that money for his service. You're going to use it for yourself. You see, it says here, they have a desire to have more and more. In verse 9 it says, but those who desire to be rich. That word desire, you know what it means? It means to have a mind or a disposition bent that way. So the desire here is to have more and more and more and more. And when you got all that you think you need, you still want more. That's what drives you here. The word love is something it's important to understand. By adding the word love, Paul is telling Timothy and that the constant craving for more and more material things is sinful. Just to be blessed by God, to have an abundance of things, and you're still using your money for his honor and his glory, that's not a sin. But here's the point. Whether you have a lot or just a little, you have to be a good steward of what God has entrusted to your care. That's the point. Because if you're not a good steward, you'll end up wanting more and more and more. Not only do we have the heart of all evil, but we have the heartache of evil. You see, when people are passionate about the wrong thing, and in this case, the wrong thing is money or the love of it, it will lead to plenty of heartache. The heartache that Paul warns Timothy about is two specific things. He says it results in people leaving the faith. When we become more concerned about getting more and having more, we easily become less and less faithful, which leads to less and less passion, less and less commitment, and eventually walking away from the truth, walking away from the faith. You could also become so consumed with getting more and more that you spend your time always working to get more. And you have no time for the things of the Lord or the people of the Lord. I like the way MacArthur quips in his summary of this. He says, for these apostates, gold replaces God. My friends, never let us get to a place where we allow gold to replace God in our lives. Because if you do, it'll be a heartache because you'll walk away from the things that you know are right. The other thing is that there's a piercing pain of sorrow. This word piercing has the idea of skewering. Don't tell me I'm gross, but this is just what the word means. Has the idea of skewering an animal. Now, when we were little, we used to go hunting with a guy in our church. And our rule for hunting was you have to eat what you kill. Okay, so we were out in the woods and we wanted to stuff a squirrel. Okay, but the guy who stuffed it, he's the guy who took us hunting, he said, if you shoot it, you got to eat it. So we shot the squirrel. And he set up a little thing and we roasted the squirrel over a fire right there in the woods. And we ate it. It was pretty tasty. But we skewered it from the bottom to the head, right through. Pierced it all the way through. Now, add to that the idea in this phrase that is the idea not just one piercing, but many. Skewered all over the place. It's not going to get away. It's not going to get out. Paul wants Timothy to understand when people forsake the truth, there will be plenty of painful things that unfold in their lives. You see, we want to make sure that we are following the ways of the Lord. We're doing what God wants us to do. Here's a thought. Some of these people that have left the faith, Some of these people that have been so consumed with the love of money were probably never saved. And they're going to face the ultimate pain, which is separation from God in a place called hell. Some were saved. And they got so caught up in having more that they simply said, I can't be busy with the things of God because I got to be busy getting more. Paul's warning. He starts off in verse 3, warning those who oppose the teaching of the truth. They're godless individuals. We should mark them and withdraw from them. If we don't, guess what could happen? We could buy into their teaching. We could buy into what they're telling us and saying, hey, you got to have more. You got to have more. God wants you to have more. That's a lie. God's going to give you what he wants you to have. You don't have to keep pursuing more and more. If we allow them to influence us, it will cool our passion for the things of the Lord. For those who are not grounded in the Word of God, they'll turn away from it. They'll leave the faith. But you know what the greatest protection against godlessness is? It's godliness. If we're practicing godliness, it leads to contentment. Not only does it lead to contentment, but it makes us effective in being passionate about the things of the Lord. When we love the Lord and we have a desire to serve Him, our love for the material cannot surpass our commitment to the Lord and our service to and for Him. You see, Paul has brought it down to where the rubber meets the road. He wants Timothy to make sure that the leaders that become pastors in the churches in Ephesus help their churches cultivate a love for God, which translates down into a love for one another, which means you're going to serve one another and you're going to be happy doing it, and it's going to fill you with contentment and joy and rejoicing in the service that you render to God by serving others. So as the week lies before us, God's going to give us opportunities. He's going to give us chances to serve Him. They're not going to come with a bow on it that says, serve God. It's going to look a lot like serving someone else. So when we take advantage of those opportunities, we understand contentment, and we are walking and living in the truth of God's Word as we live out our Christianity in a practical way that speaks to our brothers and sisters in Christ, as well as to our community that's out there that needs to hear the truth about God's Word. Our gracious Heavenly Father, as we think about your goodness to us today, we want to say thank you for loving us. We want to say thank you for providing for us all the things that we need. Father, you've gone beyond many times and in many cases what we need, and you give us often the things that we want. But help us, Father, to be content, finding our joy and our fulfillment and our service for you by serving others. Help us, Father, not to become individuals who grasp onto what we have and refuse to share it or refuse to let go of it if you should desire to take it away from us. But Father, help us to be people who are committed to being faithful members. We know that our faithfulness is measured in many different ways, and you will teach us how that faithfulness should be demonstrated. We ask that you'd help us to be committed Christians, believers, brothers and sisters in Christ, who are set on serving you by serving others. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.